we'll jump right in. This session is the first in two parts. The first one is about sales hiring, and the second one is about script building. And we are going to show you exactly how to build your first sales team and build some of your first scripts. And we may go even more into to both of those down the line and how to scale those out. So bootstrapping sales hiring, today we will start with introductions briefly. I'll talk to you about the process, the stage, the players, the execution, and then we'll open it up to question and answer. And typically I'll stop at each section so that you can ask any questions in between, because we're going to be throwing a ton of information at you.
And despite this rigid process, if you guys want to ask questions in between, do it.
Definitely. So some brief introductions. I'll let Nima go first. It's a beautiful picture.
So I'm an investor with a fund called O'Reilly Alpha Tech Ventures. And with our fourth fund, we're exploring a new theme in early stage investing, and we're calling it Indie.vc. Heavily focused on sales, business models, unit economics, sustainable kind of stuff.
Awesome, and I'm Danny Leonard. I actually work here on the distro team, and I do sales consulting as well. And we're both former sales leaders at Groupon, and we've done a few startups as well. So that's our background. Any questions? All right, so let's talk about the process of sales hiring. Like everything in sales, you need to have a process, and the process has to be well thought out and well laid out. And for those of you who have met with me and I've guided through sales process, the exact same philosophy applies. It's a funnel. You start at the top and you keep slimming the ocean down until you find that excellent, excellent hire, and that excellent hire rewards you by closing a ton of deals. So the process looks largely like this. It starts with recruiting, and we'll walk through all these parts, so if you miss it, don't worry about it. And then you go on to your screening and interviewing process, your hiring process, and ultimately your training process, because the sales hiring process doesn't just end when you hire someone, it ends well into their tenure as a salesperson. You want that person to be successful, you want that person to you know, be a part of your company culture. You spent a ton of time finding that person, training that person, educating them on what you do. It doesn't just end when you have them sign on the dotted line. Any questions on the process before we move forward?
Would you outsource any of those steps in the early days?
Great question. I would. I think outsourcing parts of it are okay, but only after you've done it on your own. So only after you've posted on many different sites and only after you've found many, many different ways to recruit people would I start outsourcing. But day one, what you have to do is you have to do it yourself. But once you have early traction, yes, outsourcing is okay.
What pieces of it do you outsource?
So we'll jump into we'll jump into it a little in a second, but I will totally get to that. But that's another great question. So let's talk about the stage. So everybody here is probably very early on, but you need to decide what stage you're at and hire accordingly. And typically, the stage falls into a variety of buckets, and it largely depends on how much, number one, how much time you have, obviously, and number two, how much money you have and how much ability to throw resources at the sales hiring process. So I break it out into five different stages. So the first one is CEO-driven sales, and many of you are here right now. So that's you as a founder, as a CEO, building up a sales process on your own. And the number one most important thing that you can do during this stage is to document everything so that when you do end up hiring that first sales rep, that person comes in with all of the pitfalls and all of the successes that you have, and ultimately you want that person to be way better. That's the reason you hire a salesperson. You want that person to be way better than you at this process. So they'll take that and hopefully they'll run with it. The next stage is CEO plus reps, and I've bolded and underlined the S in reps. No matter what, when you're hiring a sales team, early on, hire more than one rep. I can't stress this enough. As hard as your job is, or as hard as your jobs are as the founding team members, a solo salesperson with no competitiveness or no ability to talk out their problems — salespeople love talking out their problems — with no comrade to talk it out, that is a tough position for any single sales rep to be in. So hire two, start them at the same time, and team them up, pair them up, get the competitive juices flowing, and continue that process. So hire two, hire three. Any questions on the first two stages in the sales hiring process? So the question was, the first couple hires, should one of them be a manager type, or should they be a salesperson type? So I put kind of an asterisk on those first hires. They should be probably an all-around entrepreneur. You want that person to be both an excellent salesperson and potentially somebody who could grow into a leadership role in the future. That's a really hard hire to find. So the preference is to wait there as long as you can. Hire very slowly so that you can build this process up. But yeah, I mean, you want somebody who's going to close with you day one, so that person probably has to wear the salesperson hat for a bit.
If I could just add to that, I would steer away from hiring your first few sales folks and giving them any titles, because it really doesn't mean anything. So don't pat their egos. You should be honest with them and say, look, it's just you, me, and Danny, right? If you prove it out and you prove your worth, yeah, sure, you can grow into any role. But today, you're going to take out the garbage, do prospecting, and close leads, and do the account management, and et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, there's no bloated expectations or...
Question. Great question. The question was, with the two reps, should you have them do the same thing or hire different roles? I suggest doing both at the exact same time with the same role and same responsibilities. It's tough to have a junior rep and a senior rep and have them be competitive or have even a barometer on their success. So, yeah, stick to the same there. The next stage is small team. So when you're a small team, you've moved on, you have your first reps. That's when you start to bring in some sort of manager. This person doesn't have to be a VP. In fact, I recommend it not being a VP in that early stage. Against what I probably wanted as a 24-year-old, wanting to be in that higher level, wanting to be that VP title, I would recommend somebody who is a director, who has some great sales experience, but you trust could grow into that VP level higher with the right training, with the right skill building, with the right kind of production that you want to see out of that person. After small team comes bigger team. That's when you are hiring many salespeople at a time, potentially many roles. So account executives, SDRs, which we'll talk about on the next slide, potentially some sales ops folks, potentially some account management. So that's when the team starts to actually get built out. And then sales machine, which I think probably everybody in this audience is a little bit away from. That's the goal, but that's when you have a 100-person team, sales enablement, support, marketing support, multiple managers, multiple layers. So let's pump the brakes on that for now.
To take a couple of steps back, when do you hire, like at how many reps do you hire your first manager?
Yeah, so your first manager I think should be around 5 reps. Typically a manager will tap out with the ability to manage effectively on a sales team at 10. So if you give them 5, that's a good number. They'll have a ton of work and they'll probably still be able to close. So they'll earn the respect of their peers along with being able to actually manage the group. So we dropped a couple terms or shadowed a couple terms, but let's talk about the players. There's a ton. So the first player in the sales org is the sales operations or lead operations. I grouped these together, but really they're two separate ones. In fact, Nima ran all of sales operations for Groupon at a point in time, and he is the most fantastic sales operator I've ever seen. So you should try to hire him, but seems unlikely. But those folks are the people that add the juice to the sales team. The purpose of a sales operations employee is really to find the inefficiencies in the sales team and make them disappear. Make that sales team run exceptionally smoothly at all angles. So if they're caught up sourcing leads all day, not on the phones, if they can't send their emails effectively and they're sending one-offs, if you find them robo-dialing physical numbers or punching numbers into a phone, this person identifies the inefficiency and makes it go away. But do you have anything to add there? I think there's it's a little more complex than that.
No, I mean, our role internally, as we talked about it, was help sales sell more, better, faster. That's literally the sole job of sales ops. And then within the context of your sales organization, you just have to figure out where the holes are and whether the sales needs training, whether they need recognition, whether morale's down, whether you need to put in spiffs because the business needs to go after a particular type of business. And then most of the things Danny covered.
The next hire is an SDR or sales development rep. And I can't speak enough about how critical this role has become and is in a sales process these days. So the sales development rep is responsible for solely, they're responsible for everything pre-qualify. So any lead that comes in, their job is to really sell them, obviously, to make them a fan of your business, but really to weed out the people that are not going to be buyers of your product. It's a critical part of the sales team because you want your closers to be focused entirely on closing. You want those people that are trained assassins that will bring you business to be focused on what's important and not on leads that are going to waste their time and they're going to spend hours on post-close because they just didn't have the actual interest in what you're selling.
Quick question for the audience. Where do leads come from? Where do you guys get leads today? Anyone, shout it out. How do you get inbound? Okay. So
we heard content marketing, buying lists. Full-time prospecting.
There we go. That's what I was trying to get to. So essentially, leads come from one of two places. It's either coming from marketing, just put a whole lot of content and SEO, SEM, whatnot, and then SDRs are the folks that actually go and get you the leads. Now, the thing is, for most B2B businesses, you don't have the resources to spend on ads, or you don't have the time to write 85 blog posts a week, or you don't have time to do a lot of that other stuff. But what you do have time is to actually send cold outbound email or in-mails or handwritten notes or smoke signals or pick up the phone and actually call someone. That's actually you going and getting your own leads. Danny, do you make a distinction, SDRs handling inbound versus?
So at a bigger stage, when you get to many, many reps, so in the dozens, yes, but in the beginning, no. I think SDRs handle both inbound and outbound. So any lead that comes through, they're responsible for screening it and really qualifying or disqualifying the lead to pass to an account executive.
And then what about SLAs as far as dealing with inbound leads?
It's dependent, again, I think, on the size. I think SLAs, I typically like to hire MRRs, which is a marketing response rep. So an inbound lead will be qualified by that person. And that person is less of a salesperson and really just like almost an order taker. They ask them a very specific set of questions. And if it's a no-go on how to answer them, they'll kick them back into marketing. And if it's a yes, they'll pass it actually to an SDR for further qualification. Account executive is the next. I think probably everybody here is familiar with that term, but those are your closers. Those are the people that are responsible for giving demos, working deals, hunting for new deals. And these people come in many varieties. I've hired, I think probably together we've hired hundreds of reps to this point. There are many traits of an account executive that are consistent. You know, they have to be hungry, they have to love what your company does, they have to close you in the interview and end up closing deals overall. But other than that, unless somebody has the magic bullet, they come in all shapes and sizes. I've had some of my best reps, actually all time, were very quiet, but when they got on the phone, they were a force. And the only way you're actually gonna be able to prove that is by great screening in an interview, which we'll get to in a little bit, but also having them prove it out after you've hired them. So setting a very, attainable but aggressive target and having them hit that in the first 3 or 4 months. Sales manager, head of sales, VP of sales. So these are looped in small stages, but later on they're broken up. So your VP of sales is your more classically trained head of sales. That person should be focused on heavy, heavy numbers. They should be kind of almost always living in a spreadsheet, but also being able to step back and help with exceptionally large deals. Your head of sales is probably a hire that you'd have at a smaller stage when you're building your first team or have your first few reps. This person could be an entrepreneurial mindset human who wants to grow into that VP of sales role. And your sales manager is somebody who has possibly been promoted from account executive to sales manager in a previous role and wants to take a leap into an entrepreneurship type of company, or it's somebody who has some managerial experience and is early in their manager career and wants to come over to an entrepreneurship type of opportunity as well. BD sales, so this position sometimes exists. I think specifically at Groupon existed. This was a just large deal focused type of business. So they were probably too senior to focus on some of the smaller deals that Groupon had, but they weren't exactly a manager. They really went outside of that realm and focused on like really large deals. And then later on, merchant or customer success or account management. So that's all post-sale work. So with all of these players, yeah, so you need to run them through the stage to figure out where you are. So are you looking for an entrepreneurial mindset-ed insert the player, or are you looking for somebody who can just fill one role? So again, at those top three, small team, CEO plus reps, or CEO-driven sales, you're looking for the players that have that entrepreneurial mindset-ed slant to them. So those are probably people that can wear many hats that you'd like to grow into future leaders of your company.
Would you have your managers, heads of sales, directors, VPs, would you have them carry quota?
I would have them carry a team quota, and if they can't fill that team quota with the people on their team, then they will have to sell themselves. So it depends. If they hire an exceptional team, I don't care if that manager has a quota or not. But if they have hired a poor team and they need to step up and hit quota for the company, then absolutely they should carry that quota. So the question was on partner sales, and are you specifically talking about somebody who you outsource the sales to and they sell for you? Potential sales channel that is a partnership. So in my career, I have yet to see a BD deal or a partner deal where we didn't absolutely crush one side of it that has worked out. So I think the answer is those are okay, but you have to make sure that you're getting the absolute best deal, and I think it typically works out very one-sided for somebody.
More often than not in the early days, BD is vague. You still haven't figured out your business. I don't think you should hire someone just to do BD. You probably still need some transactional sales to come in. I think more often than not, in the early days, that falls on the shoulders of founders or leaders of the team.
Any other question on players, stage, or those two combined? Yeah, your question was on SDR, clarifying their role. But yes, they are prospecting and they are qualifying. So this is a outbound, largely outbound function. The luxury would be if it was all inbound, they'd have a very easy job. So let's talk about the execution, how we put all of these things together. So before you set out to hire a sales team, set up a goal. And that goal can be the amount of hires. That goal could be the size of the team that you're looking for to hit specific numbers even given to you internally or by an investor. Set your goal up, put it on paper, and set a time. So the goal could be, I want to hire a 10-person SDR team this quarter. That's a very hard goal, but you could probably do it. Set out your job descriptions and a very simple commission plan in the beginning. The commission plan will grow with you over time. It's probably worth another 2 hours to talk through exactly what a commission plan looks like, but the simpler it can be and the more directly connected to the company goals in the beginning, the better. I get asked a few times on, you know, can you incentivize users? Can you incentivize signups? Can you incentivize X, Y, and Z? The answer is no. Have your goal be tied to revenue or a revenue-driving number. So for an SDR, that's sales qualified leads. If you know those leads directly can convert into closed business. If it's an account executive, that number has to be money-driven. The further away from the company goal you get, the further away that person will feel valued in their role, and you're going to end up coming back to money with a salesperson anyways, so they're going to be thrown for a loop when you decide to shift focus.
We probably shifted sales comp at Groupon on a weekly basis with 800 sales reps. This caused a lot of drama for some time. In the earliest days was probably the most simple, where it was just a flat percentage. Never disincentivize reps to not sell, because if you structure their goals purely just based on contracts, they'll be incentivized to sandbag deals. So if you tell them you only have to close 16 deals in a month and then their commission is capped, they have no incentive to sell that month and they'll just hold on to that deal for the next month. And to Danny's point, as you learn more about your business, if all of a sudden you realize you want to go after a specific vertical, but you don't want your reps to stop going after the previous four verticals, just create a special incentive for that one vertical. That should help them. And you can make that be a short-term incentive so that your reps actually go and try to sell against that goal.
And the thing here about commission plans and about goals and hiring, have the conversation when your hires start. Explain that it's a startup, explain the stage that you're at, and explain the long-term vision, where you want to be, and how those goals directly tie into that, so that they're on the same page with, look, you know, if you are a small team, look, we're a small team, the goal is to grow into a bigger team, the goal is to, you know, hit these metrics so we can raise more money or become a public company. But to get there, we're going to shift focus, you know, a bunch of times. You have to be on board for that. So that's just a conversation. But sales reps, you know, a lot of times lead with their emotions and lead with their verbal thoughts. So having that conversation up front can prevent a lot of internal struggles and negativity on a bootstrapped sales team. So after you get done setting out a goal and a job description and a simple commission plan for each role on your team, you are going to set up your actual recruiting process. And again, this looks like the funnel I showed in the very beginning. But it starts with, you know, posting in the right places. So if you're looking to hire an entrepreneurial AE and you don't necessarily care about you know, how many years experience they have, yes, it's okay to post on a college job board, but don't look for a senior AE. on that college job board. So post the same way you would go outbound or same way you would look for leads, you know, fish where the fish are. So post where that specific role is that you just created in your job description actually is. So an example of that that worked really effectively at a previous company that I had is I had a goal to hire 10 SDRs in a very short amount of time. And the industry I was in was actually, well, we'll use an example, but let's just call it the HR industry. So what I did was I actually set a VA through Upwork in motion and had them scrape all of the junior level sales reps on LinkedIn that were at all of the competitors in our marketplace. And what they did was they pulled all their names, all their emails, and all their titles into a very simple spreadsheet. And then I sent out, and I had some folks on my team send out a 5-stage email to all of those candidates, essentially saying, like, love your background, very excited about you. And actually, that worked exceptionally well, because everybody likes to get some sort of a recruiting email. So set out a 5-stage email, had somebody screen them, and then set up an interview process. So we're still at, you know, posting, sourcing, and screening, but there are different ways to post. Obviously, there's a ton of job boards out there. LinkedIn is okay for posting, but it's about the process you have in place. So whatever it is, you're trying to fill that top of your funnel with these posts.
So whether it's with hiring or sales, most of your time and effort, honestly, should be upfront spent on research. Once you have that down, writing those 5 scripts shouldn't be difficult, right? It's your business. You should know your business. It's much more difficult to decide exactly who you're looking for. That's what's going to take the most amount of time. Once you have that down, then you can outsource it and quickly get that step rolling.
And exactly, you're trying to, you know, kind of decrease the amount of people that go through the actual funnel, unless it's an exceptional candidate, you want to hire that person. But let's talk about screening. So I set up a screening process. So before they actually get to the interview, it's a very simple screen, but it's role dependent again. So at the SDR level, I'm looking for 3 specific things and that's it. I'm looking for, you know, why are you the right person for the job? And that has to, they have to close me. They have to, you have to want that person. If you expect them to represent your company outwardly, you have to really want. So it's, you know, why insert company name, why you, and a determination question. So the question typically goes something like, talk to me about a time in your life where you were determined to get something done at all costs. Tell me about, you know, what it was, what you did, what the steps you took during, and how you either convinced something of someone, someone to do something, or you, you know, busted through a wall to get this done. When you're hiring an SDR, that question trips people up, because a lot of times these are junior hires. So the answer that I'm not looking for is, well, I was in school, I got a C on my midterm, and I was able to study really hard and turn that into an A. So that's not the question, or not the answer I'm looking for, and the reason is everybody's been through a scenario like that. You want somebody with a determination that is above and beyond anything you've seen, because this person is going to be put under a crazy, crazy environment to excel in a startup. So what you're looking for there, the best answer I've actually ever gotten was a hire that played college basketball, and she actually tore her ACL sophomore year, battled back, rehabbed her knee, and became the captain of her team and led them to some championship. Now, that's an extreme case. Not everybody has that scenario, but you're looking for something like that. It doesn't have to be crazy. It just has to be, you know, all my friends wanted to go to a movie, and I convinced a group of 10 not to go to that movie and to see the movie I wanted. So just has to be something like that. And then screening for account executives, you're looking for metrics. You're looking for folks that have excelled in previous roles. And if you're looking for an SDR that is maybe making a jump to an account executive hire, you're looking for past success. And if you're looking for an AE that has no experience, you know, revert to the SDR questions. But you're looking for past successes, metrics, And that's it. And then for managers, you're looking for, again, a little bit higher bar, but past successes. How many teams have you led? Talk to me about hiring. Talk to me about firing. Talk to me about your quota. That's what you're looking for there.
With managers, I really care about how they actually manage people out and what process they had in the past. Because sales is a competitive sport, right? I mean, you either hit your quota or you don't. As a company, you can have a process for how you manage folks out, but how strict you actually stick to that and when you make exceptions is really important. I think it says a lot about the manager, how they treat people fairly and whether they have actually a process that they put everybody through. Happy to talk details if anybody's interested in the end.
Any questions on kind of the top of the sales hiring funnel before we walk into interview? So the question was, first or second hire, would you hire junior or senior? I like junior personally, but I've seen it both ways and I've seen it work out both ways. So it's really, I think it's your feel. I would hire two at the same time. Specifically, if you're going junior, hire three or four at the same time so you have a top and you have a bottom if you set up a very simple commission plan. You want to see if they're actually good. You don't know enough in the beginning if they're junior. If you go senior, be very careful, and we'll talk about interview questions and how to set up a senior level hire interview question or interview process. But be very careful before selecting two or three senior level hires. You could wind up with something, someone that I like to call the wolf. And this is somebody who appears to be an exceptional salesperson and probably is an exceptional salesperson, but destroys your company culture and demands a ton of attention either from product or marketing. You know, it's somebody that maybe came from a huge company and is looking to go small after. Another question. So B2B, the question was on B2B or B2 government and the challenges of hiring someone young. You know, I think it's a personality thing. I think, you know, you're going to have to learn a new industry no matter what. From experience, I have always hired, I think I've shied, not always, but I've shied a little bit younger and more entrepreneurial in my hires, and it is yet to fail me. I think that person just has a little more hustle to them. But if the industry is very archaic and you want to maybe pattern match, I think that's okay. But again, I would make sure to hire two or three at the same time so you have a barometer on that type of senior level hire.
If I can jump in on that. This is really, I think, my philosophy as far as hiring salespeople. You should never hire salespeople unless you've sold yourself, because then you're not setting me up for success. If you can't look me in the eye and say, hey, when I call 100 leads, I close 4.5 in a 90-day cycle, if you can't say that, you're not ready to hire me. Or you're not really ready to set me up for success. Then you're okay with me failing and figuring it out. But then you should communicate that with me. So if you know what it takes and what you should say, and 9.5 out of 10 times what objections you're going to get from your prospects, you can teach that to your sales rep. And now she might come across other things as you learn your business and you sell, but that's just the evolution of any business. I hope that answers your question.
We have two questions. The first is, would you rather have a guy like Kevin Garnett or a guy like Randy Moss on your sales team, and why? I'm from Minnesota, so I'm sure I have a friend out there watching, but I'd rather have KG. He's a team player, and he's won a championship.
Whoa.
It's crazy. I like Moss a little bit better, but... and then the next one is, how do you set up targets, and what is the recommended ratio for base salary and commission? It's a great question. At the SDR level, I'll break it down into kind of three. The SDR level, you're looking for that almost like a 60, 70, 40, 30 split. So that's base to OTE or base to commission. And then the account executive level, I really like giving a 50-50 split so they get to hunt and the opportunity to make a ton of money as well. For both, I like uncapped commission structures if you can swing it. I think it just gives, you know, every player the ability to really set their own pace.
I think specifically as far as how much you pay them, it actually depends on whether you can afford to hire sales reps. if what you sell is $100 a month and that's $1,200, how many deals would your rep have to close per month to justify a base salary and commission? So just do the math. I mean, you might not have the type of business where you can even afford to hire an SDR or an AE. But again, if it's B2B or B2Gov, you probably have ACVs that are over 10 or 15, and most of those per deal. In most of those cases, you can't afford to hire folks.
For a lower level manager or a middle level manager, I think, you know, having something set out around that 60, 65, 40, 35 type of place is great. And for your head of sales, I would let them have a conversation with you about it. If they're into the 50-50 split, let them do it. If they're that confident and they want to have the upside, I think that's a great personality trait to have. And if you know they're more in the background, you know, 75-25, I would go as low as that if you trust that they're a exceptional performer and they'd really have to justify that. So, you know, at a startup level out here, you know, that hire could cost you 200K base. So you really have to be picky with that head of sales hire. I've seen those salaries go completely bananas, and myself not included. I've just seen and heard of crazy, crazy scenarios where a startup pays a head of sales way, way too much and it ends up backfiring.
If it's at all any help, and you can adjust this for inflation and the cost of Midwest, but at Groupon, we paid junior reps 32.5. That was their base. Once they got to the next level, the base salary was 45. Once you became a senior rep, it was 60K. Again, the upside, you know, you could make an NBA bench salary if you performed and crushed it, but your baseline salary was somewhere between 32.5 and 60K. So you can adjust that for the Bay Area and 3% inflation annually. We didn't really have SDRs. We did a little bit of everything. But yeah, for the sake of the conversation, I think an SDR around 35, so 35 in the Midwest, adjusted 15% for the Bay Area. But yeah, here, honestly, prices are just silly. So if you can afford to hire folks elsewhere, do it.
So let's talk about interviewing. And again, I'll break it out. Junior, SDR level, account executive, and manager. So we don't have to go through all of the different types of players. But the junior level, these are quicker interviews. They go rapid. Again, I'm looking for why you, why the company that they want to work at. And then I'm looking for that determination trait. At this point, I can probably identify a great SDR in 5-10 minutes, but those are the three questions that you need to get out. And the rest of the interview, I don't think you need more than three people meeting with them total. The hiring manager and possibly the two functions that interact with this person the most. So maybe it's one person from your product team and one person from your marketing team, or maybe it's the CEO and one person from your marketing team. But these interviews can be quick because this hire, you know, there's naturally a lot of turnover, and if you hire five, you'll have the three top performers kind of play themselves into or out of the role pretty quickly. The account executive style interview, I think that's a more complex interview process. So an intense screening to focus pretty much primarily on numbers, how they perform in past roles, and then a interview process with one or two people to test on sales skills. If this is your hiring manager or if you're head of sales, this person should, you know, really dig into how they interact with clients. And then another step, so screening, first interview, next interview, and that interview to me is a actual case study of a business to business or a B2C type of scenario. So you're giving them a mock situation, you're giving them a few days to prep for it, and they're coming in and they're presenting to you on what they would do in that specific scenario. So this should be well thought out, and they should know exactly what they're doing from a process standpoint, identifying all the people in the room, closing them at the end of the meeting, setting up follow-up tasks, etc. Those are all the things that they should be focusing on. And the manager level, oh, question. Again, account executives, I've seen many, many come and go. You put a little bit more time and a little bit more effort and definitely more resources and money into them. And a bad hire there can really, really affect the culture at your company. It can really send you into a tailwind. Hiring a bad account executive will suck up resources from every single person in your company, and it'll do it relatively quickly. There'll be folks that need help with marketing. There'll be folks that need help from the product people. They'll be the ones that come to product demanding features added for deals that they could have closed. So those are some traits after the fact that you should be aware of. And the best way to ensure you don't have that is to set up a intensive, again, three-step process for account executives. And after the interview, it's later on, but I'm jumping a bit, but check references on these people, specifically the account executive. You really need to dig in. So the question is industry experience versus sales experience. It really depends. If you have an entrepreneurial mindset, an account executive who wants to crack into a new industry and has a ton of great sales experience, that could be an exceptional hire if they really want to get into what you're doing. And industry experience doesn't necessarily mean they'll be great at your company. So if you're selling into government and you have somebody who's worked in government, that doesn't mean that they'll be great for your company, your tech company selling into government. That just means they've worked in government and they understand fundamentally how a government works.
Yeah, never, 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 never buy the Rolodex hype. It's pure hype. Anyone who tells you they're gonna come over and bring their Rolodex, lies. It's never panned out for me, not once. Unless, you know, I don't know, Indra Nuri from, you know, Pepsi is their aunt, maybe. Maybe they can get you into Pepsi, otherwise it's not happening.
Yeah, I have not seen that work either. So interviewing and then sales manager interviewing. This, I would love this hire to come from a referral. I think this is your wait, very slow, very methodical sales process. I think this comes CEO driven. So CEO gets intro to this person, has a screen. The screen likely comes over a coffee or a beer. And then the CEO is the one introducing this hire to the other leaders at the company. And it's really a feel thing. The CEO likely should be the one to assess past successes. They'll obviously get reference checks, you know, probably under the radar reference checks or do some background checking outside of the natural process. But this hire is going to set the pace for your sales team for presumably the next 5 years if you're lucky. So this is a slow, methodical interview that should take probably months to actually hire correctly. After interviewing, stack candidates. So when you have a big push and you have a bunch of SDRs and you have 20 interviews, after the interview, have every single person in the interview process rank them in the categories that you care about and write it down, and then have a 15-minute meeting about every single candidate to discuss the pros and cons and if they're yeses. I've seen it go both ways. I've seen processes where the hiring manager has final say and it doesn't really matter what everybody else says, and I've seen it where everybody has to be a yes. I'm kind of indifferent at this point. I've seen it be successful in both points, but I think the majority of folks in the room should be like, yes, this person is great for our team. And the hiring manager absolutely has to say yes.
I'll add just one slight revision to that. It should be a fuck yes. It's either a fuck yes or it's a no. So either have that system or have a system of ranking on an even point scale, so there's no odd numbers. So, you know, you can rank them 1 through 4, but it's not 1 through 3 or 1 through 5.
And just like a CRM, track this somewhere. So if it's a spreadsheet, fine, track it in a spreadsheet in the beginning. In the future, there's a ton of technologies out there for recruiting. They're expensive, so I don't recommend them for you guys today. But in the future, if you really want to talk about which one is the best, email me, totally cool, but they're expensive. And then finally, check references on every single candidate. And don't just ask how were they in their previous job, ask tough questions. And what I mean by that specifically is questions like, how would you rate this person in the past history of employees you've worked with? Are they in the top 5? Are they in the top 10? Are they in the top 20? Rank this person against their peer group. Why would this person fail in their next role? You know, those are the type of really tough questions you should be asking because, you know, they're going to give you somebody that's going to say good things about them. So you have to take it with a grain of salt and dig into specifically what made them so great and if you want that type of attribute at your company.
One thing I've done is going to someone's LinkedIn page and just see on the right-hand side who else shows up. If none of those people are in the references, just blind write one of those people and say, hey, I'm interviewing this person. What do you think of them?
And last, after they start them in pairs. So we already talked about this, but this is a theme. Start every sales hire in pairs with the exclusion of your head of sales. That person can't really have a pair. More on execution. So like I mentioned in the beginning, sales training is part of the sales hiring process. So sales training essentially ratifies this hire as someone great for your company, and you still have to do that. You can't just expect them to come in day one and close. Likely to have a proper sales program or sales hiring program, you're going to need a sales leader. So the training program doesn't have to be super complex, but you should have written out check-ins. You should be super prescriptive in your approach. So by that, I mean, take some time and schedule out their entire first 2 weeks and have their calendar fully blocked out with everything that you want them to cover and allotted times with homework on the sections that you want them to walk through. So let's say day one is product. You know, walk them through a guide on how to use your product, and at the end have them answer a few questions that they have to turn in to you at the end of each day. You can share it on a Google Doc. This will take a little bit of time in the beginning to set up. It's worth it to make that person feel like they're welcome. The worst hiring program that I have ever been a part was one where it was, here's a guidebook, and run with it. Here's your sales training manual, just go, and they expect you to succeed. You know, it ended up working because it became Groupon. However, they were growing exceptionally fast at the time, and they since changed their sales training program into something really, really world-class. In 2 weeks, yeah, so you're looking them to set up coffees or lunches with every single person in the office. You're looking for them to learn all the back-end organization systems in your company. So how you set up email, how you write emails, how you send your signature, Slack. A lot of people don't know what Slack is still. Calendar, proper etiquette in the office. So there's a section on that. If they're a young group, I always have a session on professionalism. So how to be a professional in the workplace, and then proper sales wins, and then over time, depending on their role, so in SDR, what I would set up is, you know, cold call 10 customers blind on day one, talk to me about what they said, moving towards something where they're sending out their first sales email or setting up their first scheduled call.
And role plays.
Role plays, yeah, right. Absolutely.
And by the way, your best sales leaders will be the ones who will stress more about setting up training processes. No sales leader will not be focused on training. So when you are interviewing for a sales manager, sales VP of sales, specifically ask them how they feel about training versus sort of short-term quota. If they focus much more on training, it's probably a good sign.
And a hack for your trainees. So when you do hire your first salespeople, have them write a guide to the session that you set up for them so that their work becomes your first training program. It's a very easy way to get a ton of leverage out of those first few sales hires so you don't have to completely repeat the work that you've done. So when you set up a system that says, hey, learn all of our internal tools, you're literally having them write out how to use all of your internal tools so that the next group of salespeople or the next group of hires that you have can follow their guides with your edits. And the last thing is build a farm system. So make this program something that shows them the path in the company from day one on where they can be. So if it's that, you know, sales manager that you really want to mature into a VP of sales, show them the path on day one and show them people that have been achieving and let them meet those people that have been achieving that path. And if it's the sales hires that are junior and it's the second batch of sales hires, have one of the high performing ones from batch one lead a few sessions so they get to know who those high performers are and they really get to follow the example of somebody who has done a great job for your company all throughout this program. So build a farm system. Just think about it kind of like a baseball farm system. You want to keep moving up, and the way you do that is aligning yourself with coaches, aligning yourself with the top players at your industry so that, or you know, in your specific role so that they mature as a group and they want to achieve what people who have come before them have actually achieved.
And I think one thing that will help is from day one, if you set a path for your younger junior sales folks, that they're not gonna forever in a day be stuck in that one role making 100 calls a day. But if you can show them a path and say, hey, if you know, for the next 18 months, if you surpass your quota 80% of the time, then you're gonna go from a junior sales rep into, you know, a senior sales rep. Like actually show them a path. And not every sales rep will wanna be a manager, right? They might have different aspirations. Maybe that's just where they happen to start in your company. They might want to get into another role. They might want to move into like an analytics role or a marketing role. Make sure you're open with them and you at least help them also achieve their goals within your organization. Otherwise, you're going to bleed talent and that's just a painful process to then go through this entire thing again.
So I think that formally wraps us for sales hiring, but definitely want to open it up to questions or tactics or strategies or war stories from the stuff that we've seen. But thank you guys for listening to the presentation, and this, I guess, formally ends it. Part one.
Thanks, guys.
Any questions? So I think the question is largely about culture, and if I hear you right, it's how to avoid the boiler room type of culture. Wall Street. You know, I think it's building a culture where other parts of the company interact with each other and really forcing that. I think when sales is separate from the rest of the company, that creates an environment where they kind of just have this group think, and I don't mean necessarily like a salesperson sits by an engineer, but I think forcing the opportunities for groups to collaborate and for your engineers to sit on sales calls and your salespeople to learn how maybe a feature gets created, I think that gives people a lot of perspective, and that's really the best way I've seen it is to open doors for people that are eager to learn, because I know pretty much every salesperson I've hired in some point has asked about, and they should ask about, like how the product works or why the product works this way. And you know, limiting their scope, I think, will ultimately limit the thoughts that they have and the actions that they take.
And I think in some companies, especially on the customer facing side, it's a lot easier to get the non-customer facing folks involved. So I know I can't confirm this now, but I know up until a few years ago, Etsy would still have its entire staff during the holiday season answer support tickets. So it didn't matter whether you were the CTO or the VP of Eng or whoever, you had to sit and feel what the customer felt. I think that kind of forcing function just bonds people together, right? You can't be separate.
And another thing is make sure that your goals and your internal metrics are understood to be kind of just like real and not just put on you for no reason. Internal goals are just that. It's a number that you're driving to, and yes, it's very, very important. But when they come at the cost of an employee's well-being, I think that's when you have to have the ability to step back and say, like, I am doing something that is really harming people at my company. So make sure that you put people first as the leader in terms of assigning and dictating goals. Other questions? The question is co-ops and interns. I think interns are great. Sales interns are a little tough because they probably won't be fully ramped by the time their internship ends, but I love putting interns on lead generation or data collection or sales enablement or things that help salespeople perform better, making presentations, that type of stuff.
Yeah, to ramp up a salesperson often takes 3 months. So again, if the end goal is, you know, 12 contracts a month, month one is 4, month two is 8, month three is fully ramped at 12. So if you have an intern, like, she just won't have the chance to really hit her goals.
So master's level health students and putting them. Yeah, I think the long tail, honestly, if you hire an intern like that and they perform well and you really like them and the team really likes them, it's an exceptional way once they go off to school to stay in cahoots and try to recruit them back to you. Yeah, I would give them a project that you've been thinking about doing for a while and you haven't been able to accomplish and see if they can knock it out of the park. Obviously, not a product-oriented product, but that's great.
And I mean, if you need to hire or if you want to hire them later, the ramp-up time for your company will be less too, right? Because they already, yeah, exactly.
So the question was on hiring and training remote. Is this across many countries as well? And do you plan to bring them all in at one point? So
I think probably the best thing to do then is to have just, you know, set checkboxes that you put them through so that you know that everyone is getting the same exact experience. What type of role are these folks doing for you? Like, what job are they doing for you? So to Danny's point, I think there's no universal answer to these things. I think just having a process and a checklist, once you go through that process, you'll learn whether this even will work for your business or not. Unfortunately, there's no good answer other than experiment.
I've had some success with assigning kind of a training captain. And that could be a good process for you guys remotely. So if that person is in charge of collaboration and you give them a very set guideline on what they should and shouldn't collaborate on, I think that could be a win too if they have some, you know, ability to hop on a video conference and work through some of the training challenges. I think that's it.
Awesome. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
We'll be right back.